Christian was born in the Philippines and raised in the San Francisco Bay Area. He spent his college years in the Philippines where he honed his knowledge about the native ancient writing system, Baybayin. Christian is a self-taught artist influenced by calligraphy, graffiti, abstract art, indigenous culture, technology, and Asian writing systems. Currently based in San Francisco, Christian has been tirelessly advocating a reawakening of the indigenous spirit through decolonization and Baybayin. Conscious about the role he played, Christian launched his official company around the script, specializing custom art, translations, books, and apparel. This led to him touring Madrid, London, and Brussels in July 2013. He is currently working on his fourth book, documentary, producing events, and online school. Welcome, Christian.
Imagine 1,000 years of culture on the brink of extinction, gone forever. So this little thing is me. Like many Filipino Americans, my family migrated to the U.S. because of martial law, whether they were directly affected from it or they just wanted to not deal with that. My family came over in the 70s. First home in San Francisco was across the street from Dolores Park. So, because of this, right? A lot of us, you know, are here because of this person. Ferdinand Marcos declared martial law. You know, we all know the stories. So this kind of directly influenced the work that I do. I'll get back to that. So San Francisco, right? So I landed first in San Francisco with my family, but then I moved to the East Bay. And when I moved to the East Bay, it turned into this multicultural neighborhood in Fremont, California, East Bay, right? Yeah, suburbs. So I have a lot of friends, and I have friends that were white, black, Chinese, Filipino, of course, Cambodian, every single race you could imagine. That dude right there, that's me. So one of the things, though, that I noticed was that I was a jealous boy because a lot of my Polynesian friends, you know, they had their dances, the hula, the Tahitian dance. And a lot of my Filipino friends would also take these Tahitian dances. And then on the flip side, I would go with my parents to Civic Center to a Filipino festival, and I'd see tinikling and these other things that I couldn't relate to. And it wasn't as sexy as my Polynesian friends, and they had their own language. It seemed very familiar. Some of it sounded like a Filipino language. They're brown like me. I went to Hawaii, and they're calling me Bra. So it felt like home, but it was just so similar. I couldn't really connect. Then one day in school, many of you probably have done this in elementary, the teacher asked me, make a family tree. And then when I meet my family tree, it's like, oh crap, I gotta talk to my parents and my Lola, Molo. And then every time I ask them about Philippines, I don't know. It's a long time ago. It was hard. You know, we don't talk about that. You're in America now. So when I did my family tree, it wasn't actually a tree. You know, my other classmates, my white classmates, they had a big ass tree. It was long. It was like an oak tree chasing their roots back to the Duke of York or some sort of royalty in Europe. But mine was wide. Mine had lots of titos and titas and lots of cousins. So mine was more like a bush than a tree. Until recently when my titos went back to the Philippines to do some research in the province of Pangasinan, where my father's from, I looked at our family bush, I shook it, and then a friar actually came out. So in high school, I gained a lot of, say, my consciousness through hip-hop in the 90s. You know, we had Public Enemy, you know, and then Poor Righteous Teachers, BDP, and of course, Bob Marley. And I discovered all of these, you know, these musical greats. And what happened was that I was like, man, these guys really know themselves. And I was like, who am I, right? Who is my St. Malcolm X? Who is my Martin Luther King, right? Who is my Marcus Garvey? who are the ones that are kind of like waking up the youth and saying, wake up and find your roots. I didn't really have that. I just had, in the 80s, like Dolphy, you know, my parents in Pasig, Colombia. And so I didn't really have that. So then one day, I went to this place here in San Francisco with my Lolo, and I was about 8 years old. I said, hey, what is that funny writing? He said, oh, that's how Chinese people write. And I asked him, Lolo, how did you write when you were a kid in the Philippines? And he said, oh, we wrote in English. That seemed kind of weird to me, but at that time, I couldn't write. Comprehend, but I said, how come Chinese people write in this weird way, but we write like Americans? And I didn't really think of like, what why is that, right? And at the same time, I found out that who I was, but not through, say, my parents or some cultural immersion, but my classmates, right? Because, you know, I was in school, I was in second grade, and they said, hey, what are you? You know, and me, I said, I'm American. He said, no, you're not. I said, oh, I'm not. So I went home and asked my mom. He said, I'm not American. I said, no, you're not. And I said, what am I? And that's kind of where I started becoming curious. Then one day, I was in these ancient books that no longer exist. And I went to the letter P. So these ancient books reveal this ancient image. Not really ancient, but this is a Katipunan flag. So the freedom fighters, you know, being Independence Day in the Philippines, you know, I saw this and I said, oh, well, that's pretty cool. The letter I for independence. But what happened was I saw that poster at a Filipino festival and I asked the man that was selling books. He said, I was trying to brag like I knew something, which I didn't. He said, hey, that's I for independence, huh? But yeah, I know my stuff. But I thought, no, that's K. That's our old writing system. But after that, I said, whoa, that's cool. I didn't know we have that. And he told me a little about it, but I couldn't find anything. I went to San Francisco Library, asked a bunch of people, no one knew anything about it. Not even the Chinese guy in my high school that ran our Filipino club, he didn't know about it. Right. So I was shocked. So then I went back to the Philippines, and I went there for vacation for about, supposed to be there for 8 months, but I ended up staying for 10 years. And one of the places I visited was this Mecca. So if you're not familiar with this Mecca in the 90s in the Philippines, it's Mega Mall, right? So I didn't know how to commute, so I walked there from where I lived, took half an hour, and I picked up these two books. And these two books kind of gave me the context of the Philippines. And these are just basic textbooks. One is The History of the Filipino People, and then a past revisited by Renzo Anton Constantino, which I consider kind of gave me that figure. Like, okay, this dude has that Malcolm X vibe. You know, I remember a passage he was writing in the 70s, and he said, like, Filipino entertainment is a pacifier of the nation. And I said, whoa, I've never heard a Filipino guy talk like that. I only heard them sing American songs and tell dirty jokes. That's the whole concept growing up as what I knew as my Filipino role model. So, an important thing happened in the Philippines around 96. And when this thing came out, the internet, it's like, whoa, now I got information, I can reach out. So one of the first things I Yahoo, I looked at the script and I found this guy, this website, and it had a lot of information which weren't available in any books or anything like that. And then I said, whoa, this is pretty interesting. So I started emailing the guy back and forth, and then I found out that, oh, he's not even Filipino, he's a white guy in Canada. He's an expert in our culture, like so many other foreigners are. And then I also contacted this guy, Hector Santos, who's in LA. Just recently passed away a couple years ago, but the combination of these two gentlemen's websites helped me gain the knowledge. And then I was ready to kind of start to write it myself while having the cultural context. And one of the things I did was start my own blog on GeoCities. All the old people are laughing. So then what I did was I used that ka sign that I first saw as a kid. So then, long story short, you know, I was in the Philippines, I said, all right, man, I'll try that. So I go back to San Francisco, fly back, and then I'm in America. And then what happened was I got so homesick. And then so I contacted this guy named Alex Figueroa down in LA area. And I started talking about if I want to get a tattoo in the script, and then we were just talking culture, and he said, you know, you should get back into it, like your art. I said, maybe, yeah, because of there wasn't any value. I was writing it in the Philippines, I knew it, but there wasn't any value other than my cousin saying, hey, there's that, my Amboy cousin, he can write in the old alphabet. That was the, you know, that was kind of like their little pen. That was the value. But, so, I got the tattoo of my last name, Kabuway, on my arm, and I wanted to kind of promote it, put it somewhere. But then people weren't really that, the community wasn't that strong on MySpace or Friendster. So I created my own website called Pinoy Tattoos, strictly just to upload the tattoo and then start the conversation. At that time, I didn't have a really good job, so you know, people would email me and ask me, hey, can you translate this and that, and I would do it. And then I said, why don't I put a little PayPal link up there for $5? And then that PayPal link worked. I said, whoa, people actually pay for this? I said, all right. So then we do $5, $10, $15, and so forth. Then I had this little side gig that was happening. But then I didn't really want the script just to be known for tattoos. So I started by lane.com to focus more on art and the educational and the surrounding context of it. And then that led to other things such as clothing line, apps, an online school, documentary that I've been shooting since 2010, books, live art performances around the Bay Area. This one here is an Asian Art Museum in 2013, and 2012 actually. And then that led to other opportunities to travel, as Sammy mentioned, to these cool places and an exotic place called Kansas City, Missouri. So, if you want to go there, meet the Filipino community, it's interesting. So, what does this have to do with the workshop? So here's a breakdown. I have a powerful statement. So one thing I learned in giving talks is that, you know, you want to skip the thank you for being here, like you want an Emmy, right? You just get to your point, make a powerful statement, just get to the point, grab their attention, right? And then have a cool story. So I told you my story, and make it personal, right? Show yourself. You know, it's hard for us to talk about ourselves, so try and make it personal. You know, and then show the journey, like where you were as a kid, and then how you became to where you are now, right? So do that. And then also how did you do it, right? So how did you actually learn about the script. So you already know what people are gonna ask you about whatever cultural practice you're doing. If you're a dancer, then they're gonna say, how did you get into dance? When, what age, you know, what's your first dance? And you know, what type of music? So you already know those questions, so already address them. You know, you wanna show the growth too. You know, when you didn't know anything until you know a lot. Use real world examples, and here's one. So, by being in the diaspora. I think that came to America with the Mono migration. This gentleman is Dan Inosanto. He is the heir to Bruce Lee's martial arts, but he's also a Filipino martial artist. I did a talk at his studio a few years ago, and because he wants all his instructors to know about Philippine culture. So when he came, he was so proud. He's like, hey, I'm glad you're here. He says, I know how to write the script too. I'm like, really? I thought he can write one character, but then I asked him, I gave him a canvas and he wrote his last name, Inosanto. And I asked him, how did you learn this? Oh, I had a calendar at home and I asked my dad what that was. And then he said, oh, that's our writing, let me teach you. Then his dad came in the early 1900s. So this is an example of their diplomas, martial arts Thai diplomas, that they give in the 80s. This Maganda magazine out of UC Berkeley, and these were in the mid-90s. This is another 90s icon, Pinay, the Filipino in vogue. And you'll notice that if you see any Filipino women in their late 30s, maybe 40s, and they may have this tattoo that says Pinay, it doesn't say Pinay, it actually says Diwa, but no one really knew back then. So those are real world examples that I just gave you. So you should share your ideas as well. So everyone has ideas. So in order to be like if you're trying to promote culture, you have your own personal ideas, not an idea of another practitioner or something that you found on the internet, but your own, like this. Identity is trust. You know, without trust, there's no identity. I think we can agree with that. And this is an example of identity equaling trust. These are business cards with intimate businesses, I like to say. Intimate business like a mechanic, a doctor, a lawyer, things that you really have to know the person. You're gonna go to the person that you know that speaks your language, knows your culture, and is your compadre, right? So Chinese usually go to Chinese, right? Filipinos go to Filipinos because you kind of know each other. And I learned that when my father was in real estate, another personal business, I used to hang out at his office and people would come in and they would speak to him in Spanish. He goes, oh no, no, I'm not Mexican. They'd come in talking in Chinese and I said, oh no, no, I'm not Chinese. And there was some other brown person would come in and talk to him in English and they'd be talking and after a few minutes, they'd have this look of, are you Filipino? Yeah, I'm Filipino. Oh, I'm Filipino. And they'd talk to each other in Tagalog. So we don't recognize each other. So without something that's visual that can say that this is a whatever business that I speak your language and from your culture, just like these examples, we don't really have that in our community. So these are some examples in the Philippines. You know what this is already. You already know what culture this restaurant is. This is Thai. Here are some examples of some restaurants. This is a plaza down in LA. You may not be able to read Hangul, but you can recognize it. This is a Filipino restaurant, very plain. It could be Joe's Crab Shack. Or we have to spell that out literally. Filipino, right? So I'm sure everyone here knows Seafood City, right? So the problem with Seafood City is that the marketing does not match what's inside. You see Seafood City, you bring some person that doesn't know, they say, oh, there's lobster, caviar, and all this great seafood, but you go in, there's like bungalows, and some guy chopping stuff up, they're gonna be shocked, right? Goldilocks too, you'll think it's some German bakery, right? Or some exotic, you know, European brioche or whatever, but you go in there, there's lumpia and all these other things. Like that. Does not match. It's like we're almost tricking them to come in. So show data. So if you have data, show it. It'll make your advocacy much stronger. So this is an example. There are about 3.4, probably closer to 4 million now, Filipinos in the US. And you know, this is from the last census. That's a lot, right? So when you have your data, you can also make a comparison. So just within the Bay Area, there's an estimated about 400,000 Filipinos. Right? That's a lot, 400,000. But in comparison to 40,000 French, right? But the French have about 8 K through 12 schools. To support the 400,000 Filipinos, we have zero schools. So what does that say about our culture in terms of investing, right? But you also want to break it down. When you're giving your talks, you want to break it down again and again to make it very specific so that anyone can understand. So the typical interest sequence in any cultural, say, hobby, it starts off as a hobby. You know, we have cosmetic, you get tattoos, buy shirts, buy art. Second would be education. You know, you're attending workshops, right? Then you start to get more interested in it. Then next, you can actually then maybe become a practitioner, right? And then an advocate. So the way that it's broken down is that the first two are more on the consumer spectrum. Like, you're buying something, you're going to become a provider. On the other side. So basically, the advocates and the practitioners are providing a service or a product or some knowledge to those that are within the cosmetic and educational track. They're consuming that information or consuming that product. So the job of the practitioners and advocates is to provide value to those that are within the cosmetic and educational tracks. So this is a Venn diagram that I like to use, identity, emotion, and preservation. So within scripts, but you can use this for anything, one for cultural identity, for promotion of what? Promotion of culture, right? And that leads to preservation, because without any value, it's not going to be preserved. Because why are you going to preserve something if there's no value? So it's up to culture bearers to provide that value, whether it's cultural, economic, social, so cultural, social, economic. And here's an example of economic. So this is bistek. They use a script in there to write bistek. Another example is I had a client in the UK called Pepe's Kitchen. they had an issue because people thought they were Spanish. They were going there, hey, where's the paella? But they wanted to attract young Finglish, Philippine English, that right? Finglish. They want to attract them, but they didn't because they always thought that it was Spanish food. So they used the script. I redesigned their logo, saying Pepe. You might not be able to read it, but you can recognize it. The menus have paybayin in it. So it kind of gives them that feeling. You know, when you go to a Thai restaurant, you can't read the script, but you know that Pad Thai is good, right? You see like, the lady with the long fingernails and the Buddhas. You feel like you're immersed in that culture. But I think we need to do that more as business owners, because sometimes we get mixed messages, right? So here's an example of that mixed message. Right? This is a soy sauce that's a Philippine company. You know, it says Bai Pinoy, but then we use the Chinese script, right? And others like say Ling Nan, right? You have the cat one like this, and then a Buddha, and then you have Len Zhong. It's like all this mixed, because we are a hodgepodge of different cultures, right? So outline your struggle. This is an example of that. So revival challenges of the script. There's not that many books out there. There's none. I've written almost all of them, which is sad. It shouldn't be like that. There are no standards in the script. There's no full-time advocates. Believe it or not, this isn't my full-time job. I don't make hella money from this. Artist respect. You know, as artists, we always have, you know, trouble gaining that respect. There is a lack of data around, like, if we can say, how many know Hila? I don't know. I know my Lola, my Tito, or some people, but we don't have hardcore data, right, for those things. We don't know how people write by begin. We don't know how many people actually are practitioners. And there's no teachers either. There are some teachers that teach a little bit, but we don't have full-time dedicated teachers. And there's also issues of like Philippine-born versus the diaspora, right? Like, you know, you're a Philippine, and what right do you have to say, represent me, you're re-cultural appropriating, you know, my tribe, and then, you know, you don't know who you are, so you should stop doing it and just be American, whatever that is. So those are some issues that you may come across. And then there's also academics versus practitioners. You'll see that. I mean, a lot of academics will study the hell out of something, but then criticize the practitioners for not practicing it right. So you'll come across, when you do talks about your cultural practitioner, you're gonna come across, you know, issues like this. And this is a screenshot from Twitter. This person from the Philippines is saying, dear social studies, explain how I'm going to use Alibata when I'm directing films, treating patients, and defending clients, and being a superhero. So from their viewpoint, there's not that much practicality. So whatever you're practicing here, we have to keep in mind of what the reality is back in the Philippines. We have the privilege to do what we can. But there's also an issue with this. So we have, you know, different regions, different languages, and different cultures in the Philippines, right? Bisaya, Pangasinan, Kabambangan, Ilocano, etc. And then becomes this one big, great, mighty Filipino, right? And of course, the head is Filipino, so no one really cares about the toe, right? So then that's kind of like what's happening. So we have to be, you know, aware of that. And when the script becomes more popular, it's going to be prone to errors. There's a government website and they just screw it up and just said gibberish. And people get tattoos, not really knowing what it means. Like, this is supposed to say tatang, which is slang for father, but he forgot to put a marker, so it says tatana, meaning to be stupid. So, then within the script specifically, there are still tribes. There's still one tribe that writes it. And I think that for myself and Ray and other practitioners of the script, like to sort of not put so much focus on the tribe that is still living it and it's on the brink of extinction is, you know, an issue. So I was just there a week ago or 2 weeks ago, and, you know, it's like we have to put more focus onto it, because why are we going to say we want to save it, but we can't give them $5 a month, you know, which is cheaper than our Netflix and chilling subscription. So what does it do to, you know, the kids out there? Like, how does it help, you know, the issues that are in the Philippines? How do we address that? That's a question. So, culture there. So, I like this definition. A person who has consciously embodied culture and is in the process of transmitting it. I like that one a lot because everyone is able to do it, right? You just have to know something, have some knowledge, and be able to transmit it. So these are kind of like my thoughts on successful culture bearing. One is going, go beyond consuming, because we can bury our heads in books and internet articles and Facebook debates, whatever, but that's just consuming information. So you want to have like a greater output than what you're consuming. You know, go home, wherever you're from, right? Go home and learn. You know, instead of going to Hawaii, which is already halfway to wherever you're going, right? Go there, it's just a couple hundred more dollars. But you also want to leave a mystery too. Get people wanting more. You know, don't say like, tell every little thing, right, that you know. It can get exhausting and boring. And so leave some mystery. Check your privilege. You know, just that I'm able to be here and talk about it, or even use the words like appropriation and authenticity. But when you go home, they don't give a shit about that stuff. They'll wear a Monsanto shirt, even if they're eating the poison. They just want, you know, to get by, right? So by us having these discussions is a privilege. So we have to be aware of that. But then don't forget about humor, because humor and telling stories is like the best way for people to remember information. And then don't forget to document. Record everything, you know, type it out, keep the journal, take pictures. I like this, have a product or have something tangible that people can walk away with, whether it's a business card. I meet a lot of some cultural barriers and, you know, they don't have a card. It's like, how do I contact you, or, you know, more information. So have something for them to take away. Be uncomfortable, because being uncomfortable kind of helps you learn and grow and be in situations that kind of will help you step up to that next level. Have a mentor. So try and find someone that, you know, that can mentor you in whatever you're doing. But then also try and have an apprentice too, because then you can learn from them and you can give back. Experience failure. Just do things out there and fail, and then learn from it. No struggles, not just your own, but no others, and see where the connection is. And then ultimately, what makes you happy, right? There's this formula that I found, which is happiness equals smiles minus frowns. Have a child's mind, right? You know, be a kid, because when we were all kids, we used to draw and didn't care about, oh no, I wonder what they're gonna see on Facebook about it, right? You know, just do it, right? Be free. And then don't forget to dream, right? Because we're always busy, we're always hustling, and, you know, just don't forget to dream and, you know, try to make that a reality. Be awesome at something else other than whatever your cultural advocacy is. Like if you're a dancer, but then you're good at marketing or an accountant or e-commerce business. So you could bring those outside skills into whatever you're doing, or you can help someone else. But explore your talents, right? Everyone here has a talent. So explore, but talent is everywhere, right? Everyone here has a talent. So the key is to take advantage of opportunities, right? Opportunities are not global, you know, they're gonna come. So you have to learn how to identify them and take advantage. But as a culture bearer, know that you may love your job, but it's not gonna love you back. It's hard work, you know. Hard work, you could lose money, lose relationships, you know, it's tough. But finding your culture is ultimately finding yourself. And finding yourself is finding your purpose. And I like to say that I consider myself culturally homeless. In America, I'm kind of like, I don't know if I kind of belong here. The one in the Philippines, I don't know if I belong there. I kind of miss the convenience of America. But, you know, I actually find my home in others. So I kind of like put that out there, and then hopefully others will accommodate me. So tomorrow, like 6:13 Monday, so after all this information that you're consuming, what are you gonna do? Like, what's the next steps? So beyond consuming all this information, what's next? So the fountain of youth is your legacy, and if you leave a legacy, you live forever. And my last tip, finish with impact and a call to action. So that was my impact statement. And so there's a call to action, and I think, thank you. We'll be right back.